to our program. We'll be talking a little bit about risk stratification and the practicality of using risk prediction equations in your community practice for treating patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension. The reason that risk prediction is important is because it identifies rapid progressors, particularly in the community setting and among individuals and practitioners who are far less experienced. It provides a basis for institution of types of therapy based on need, and also provides an opportunity to enhance consistency across therapies. What we mean by this is that the sickest patients get the most aggressive therapy, and the most well patients can probably get less aggressive therapy. It also, very importantly, identifies timing for lung transplantation, which remains the only cure for this disease. Well, this next slide shows typically how we assess risk in the community at present. We look at demographic factors, functional class, functional capacity, as whether measured by the 6-minute walk distance or a fancier method like VO2 testing. We look at hemodynamics derived from the right heart catheterization, neurohormones like the NT-proBNP level, and other laboratories like troponin and creatinine, as well as looking at RV imaging. This next slide demonstrates the predictive ability of these various factors, as was discovered in the various registries that looked at the longevity of patients with pulmonary hypertension. And you can see in this slide very easily that a variety of demographics, assessments of functional capacity, labs, imaging, lung studies have all been validated in being able to predict risk in patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension. This slide demonstrates the current risk factor profiling that was published as part of the European guidelines for treatment of pulmonary hypertension. And it's a nice simplistic method in order to organize patient risk, but it has problems associated with it. As many people who know see these patients in a clinic, no one patient fits into any one of these particular silos, so that you can have a patient who's functional class 2, but then walks 220 meters, but also may have a very elevated BNP level. Well, the problem with this is you don't know how to equate their risk when they have hits in each one of these particular silos. The other problem with this very simplified scoring system is that these factors aren't weighted against each other. So you don't know whether an elevated BNP is more important than a longer 6-minute walk distance. And that's where the rise of risk equations and risk algorithms come in. There are several risk equation algorithms that are presently available to use, and the REVEAL risk score is one of the most common. This is a calculator that was derived from a very large registry of pulmonary hypertension patients, in which we found 19 easily obtainable variables from both demographics, exams, and diagnostic studies that have been shown to be highly predictive when used in a cumulative scoring system for patients with pulmonary hypertension. Now, the interesting thing about this particular risk score is that it's useful at any time in therapy, such that you can calculate risk at baseline and also after several months of therapy to continue to plot how a patient will survive through this very devastating disease. In addition, unlike other scoring systems, this can be used for any type of pulmonary arterial hypertension, not just idiopathic, which was confined to those used by the French and also the original NIH equation. And it allows for a very common integer expression in addition to calculate a final score. The scoring can then be used to look at individual survival, and this is an example of how each of the individual scores can be segregated into survival curves. And this gives you a very accurate depiction of how a patient will do throughout their clinical course, and will allow the physician to appropriately identify patients who are not doing well, so they can be very, very aggressive to try to improve this patient's functional ability, and hence their overall survival. The risk prediction score has been validated in several other registries as well as in newly diagnosed patients. The score can also be used serially as shown in this slide, and changes in the score, either worsening or improved, has high predictive value. In addition, the recalculation of the absolute score at any time frame after therapy has been induced has been shown to be accurately predictive in telling you the subsequent 1-year survival in these patients. So now we have a score that's been validated prospectively and also shown to be useful in determining serial risk. Well, how can we apply these risk equations in the clinical practice? If we go back to the standard risk silo that we discovered earlier, we can replace these low, intermediate, and high risk silos with scores, such that a low risk score is, it would be a reveal score less than or equal to 7, an intermediate score can be 8 to 9, and a high risk score greater than 10. So you can more accurately depict with a high degree of calibration these patients' risks. And very important for the community practitioners, when they see a patient who has a score greater than or equal to 8, this is a person whose attrition is going to be very high and who should be best handled by an expert center. So it gives us a key reason and rationale for referring patients into the centers where there's experience, and also for those who need transplantation. Well, here is another useful practicality for the score. As you've seen in prior guidelines, the way we depict what drug we use for our patients is really based on a singular factor. And we now know that these singular factors, including the WHO functional class, is not the best predictor of risk. So we can replace these singular surrogates now with scores that allow you more to accurately and successfully use the medications that we have to treat these patients, with the sickest patients getting IV prostacyclins and the less sick patients probably getting mono or dual therapy with oral medications. Well, we've made a lot of adjustments in the REVEAL score based on advice and critiques from community practitioners and also expert PH physicians around the world. And we've updated the score, which has been being presented at the 2017 ATS meetings. What we've done with the existing score is we've determined more cut points for the individual variables to make it much more versatile. We've also added in new variables like hospitalizations, which we know predicts significant increased risk for 6 months after that occurs, and also have provided measurements of the GFR instead of just assessing renal insufficiency. And with the updated risk score, you can see several things. One is that there is a much better delineation of risk at low or moderate scores, but also a much better delineation of risk at high scores. So now we have a system with high fidelity and high calibration to accurately determine risk in your patients that you're treating with pulmonary arterial hypertension. To summarize then, I think the important things to learn about the use of risk stratification and risk equations is that no one singular factor should be used to modulate anyone's risk. Risk should be determined by an aggregate of factors that are collected easily and accessibly in your clinics. The use of risk equations helps you solidify risk by bringing these factors all into one simple-to-use calculator equation to best help you determine both the aggressiveness you which you need to treat people, the type of therapies that you can use, and also the need for expert referral. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope this was a good learning experience for you.